Welcome to a new OutPower tutorial. Today we'll be talking about integration services and how we could use them in OutSystems. We go through some of its theory and then jump onto an exercise where we make use of light processes to handle database queue. Without further ado, let's get to it. Let's start by going over some basic concepts of an integration with a queue pattern. If we integrate with an external system, it's good practice to abstract the concepts that you want to bring into OutSystems application. With this approach, you gain system independence, all the modifications to the external system only affect the implementation of the concept and not its consumers, and the extensibility, normalization, and optimization. This translates into the opportunity to improve the concept with either data and business rules from your application or from other external systems. Let's start by considering that the concept can be, for example, a customer, a product, etc. The idea is to have an integration service per concept, and not a single integration point per external system. One concept may be used in different systems, and integration service abstracts that complexity. Also, if a system shares several concepts, this way they won't impact each other. The integration service wraps up the existing calls to the external system. This way we can hide integration complexity and abstract the service, making it easier to be reused. When wrapping an external system call, we should take into account a few considerations. Let's give a look at the following structure. Validation and security logic. Check the consistency of the inputs, and if required, raise the user exception to propagate the error. Authentication logic. Prepare any authentication credentials required to call the external API. Map inputs. Map the inputs into a format required by the external API. Call and audit the external API. Call the external API and audit the call if integration trail is required. Error handling. Treat success and error message outputs, raising exceptions instead of returning those outputs. Set outputs. Map the return structures into the expected outputs. Exception handling can be used to audit integration exceptions or normalize exception messages that can end up in the user interface. This pattern represents direct integration with the external system, using the integration service for service abstraction. In this scenario, data is coming from an external system. Concept IS interfaces with the external system, abstracting the API. This allows that if needed, we can change the external system with no impact on the core services. Also, please note that this scenario does not have entities in Concept.cs to keep a local replica of data. Not keeping replicated data outside of the external system might be due to business constraint or because real-time demand is incompatible with having a delayed data replication. Even if it is possible, gather the data required for this use case directly from the external system normally is not a good option because the time that is necessary to obtain the data will be slow and will impact the end-user experience. Due to this, next we will see a caching method where we will store some of the data for quicker access using OutSystems aggregates. There are multiple layers of caching, each one with its own purpose. Having different caching layers allows you to fine-tune each layer in order to boost performance when dealing with large amounts of data. Typically, we use cache approach when dealing with the following situations: integration with an external master of record, pre-digest of hot business processes, data mashup for dashboards, on mobile to support the optimized data model, on mobile to support offline. Please note that, although there are multiple layers, you don't always need to have a complete set of data layers. Make sure you design your architecture according to your requirements. When it is necessary to improve the performance of the integrations with external systems, a good starting point is to cache data that doesn't change frequently. This is called cold data, which gives a name to the caching pattern, cold cache. Cold cache is used when it's too costly to synchronize the entire database, and detail is only required for single entries, while summary data must exist to allow us to search for any entry. Only summary data that is frequently listed, joined, or searched is cached. On this system, full and frequent synchronization is avoided, because summary information doesn't change that often. To implement a cold cache, the simplest approach is to create a caching data model and set up a batch synchronization process to manage the cached data. Adding local entities to the Concept.cs allows us to overcome the limitations of direct integration pattern and actually create a full-blown core service. This makes the integration service more simple. Instead of providing several methods for different data retrieval necessities, it only has to supply a method to fetch all the relevant data updated since the last sync. Concept.cs has a timer that runs on a regular basis to synchronize the information through the integration service. This synchronization should be only in one direction to avoid complex merges of information. If an update is made in Concept.cs, you must make sure that the update is successful and committed on the external system first. The biggest downside of this pattern is that there is a period of time in between batch syncs where the data might be outdated, A cold cache with summary data that is required for search, listing, etc. is very stable and won't require real-time sync. However, some situations require summary information to include fields that need to be up-to-date in real-time for the application to work consistently. Real-time sync requires the external system to call back OutSystems, notifying of some change in real-time. If this integration has a large volume of changes, one of the appropriate approaches is to create a queue that triggers a process whenever the record is created or updated in that queue. For example, this way we can bring a large amount of unrefined data, create a queue event to process X amount of records from that data, let the process trigger and work with those specific rows. Now that we have some understanding of cache and integration patterns, we need to come up with a strategy to fill that cache. For this, we should look at our use case and see what fits better. In our case today, we are going to rely on an event queue to fetch the necessary data for our system. The strategy recipe that we're going to use relies on a scalable queue prompting the data to be gathered in a queue event, but using light processes to process the data. Defining how and when the cache is filled can be challenging. There is no one-size-fits-all pattern. Every business case is unique, so triggering of the cache creation should be aligned with the business requirements. We are going to take a simple approach to this problem. The idea will be to prove a simple base strategy that can be used and expanded by everyone. Our approach will be to demonstrate how to pick up unrefined data for our system, group it into one event, and demonstrate how to set and trigger light processes. Let's start by setting up an ispace. This will be our integration service that will have a timer in which we'll call an API from an existing external system requesting the data that we need to be synced. And this is the output structure. So let's build a cache for the unrefined data. Now, let's build our queue, where we'll put our queue events. Because I want to keep track. Let's give it a batch. Whenever we create a product cache, we'll put a batch code, a GUID or of some sort, and then we know which product cache we are processing. Okay, going over the code from the beginning, we have two tables, product cache and queue. Product cache, apart from the batch attribute, represents a replica of the information that's coming in from the API. The queue has a start row, end row, a flag to say if it's processed or not, a created on, and an updated on. These three are just to control in what step of the process our data is. We also have a side property, which is queue number rows. This represents how many rows we want to group up for each queue event. Then we have an action that's being used by the timer. Going over the code inside of the action, this is a very simplistic approach. The external system just retrieves the data. It doesn't have a login system, it doesn't have any type of security around it, and the only output that it gives us is actually the response. We have a null exception to try and capture any error that comes from calling the API and registered in the service center logs. We start up by setting the batch, so we generate a GUID. Then we iterate through all of the response from the product list. We create a replica of the data with the batch. A very simple approach into creating the X amount of rows for our queue event. We have a counter. We verify if the counter has reached the number of rows that we want. If it's the first row, we set up the record. If it's a subsequent row, we set up the record this way. We also have a current iteration. This represents the last row of the previous iteration. So when it goes to the next cycle, it knows which one was the last one and sets it as a starting row. Then we create the queue, we reset the counter again, and go for the next iteration. Once we're done with running through all of the records, we exit our iteration loop. We check if our counter has values in. If it does have value, that means that it did not reach the maximum amount of rows, so it still has rows to be added to our queue event. So we set up the record from the current iteration all the way to the end of the length of the list. Again, the control fields, and then create the final queue event. And we exit. And this is our timer to fetch all of the product values from the external system. Again, this has no security validations, no input validations, no credential validations, nothing of everything we've talked about in our presentation, where we say how to wrap up, how to properly wrap up an API call. Please, always do it properly, wrap it up. And we publish this. We also need to set up the product cache and the queue as public, because now we are going to create another eSpace as a service, and this will be our core service. In the product core service, we'll create a live process that will trigger once we create a record on the event queue. Once the process is running, this will go through the records that we've specified on the event queue and processes them, giving us our final refined product data. Okay, our tables need to be public. Let's not forget that our queue actually needs to be exposed for the process. Okay, we publish. Let's start by adding the dependencies that we need. So let's look for our integration. Add the tables. Now let's add the process. Let's set the trigger. So we want it to trigger on create queue event. Okay, now we have our process. Let's add an automatic activity. In here, we'll write a SQL query that will fetch all the rules from X to Y. For that, we'll use a CTE. Let's start by defining our CTE structure. Okay, our CTE is complete. Now we just need to specify the start and end row. Now we have our rows. What we need next is our final product table. So in here, let's just create something to represent our product that's going to be used by our application. So we've had talk with an integer, is active boolean, created on datetime, updated on datetime. These are our typical control attributes. Okay. Let's go through the code once more. We have a process that triggers when we create a record in the queue. We trigger an automatic activity. In the inside of the automatic activity, we get the queue by ID. From there, we get the start and end row of our product cache. We fetch the rows using a CTE. We iterate through those rows and check if the product exists or not. If the product does not exist, we just simply create the product. If it does not, we check if it needs to be updated. If it needs to be updated, we set up the rows and update the product. Lastly, we set up that the queue has been processed and when it was processed. These are just for information. We're not using them for anything else. And now that we've created the eSpace, we need to enable it for live processes. For that, we need to go to the Operation tab and eSpace of the Service Center. Oops, let's just publish this first before we can do that. Now that we are in the Product CS Service Center page, we need to go to the tab Operation, select the live process execution, apply, we return to our application. Let's just go to data. Let's verify if we have any data. No. Now we check the queue. No records to show. Finally, our product. No records to show. Now that we've published again, now we will start getting the process compilation, warning us that the process queue is a live process. we go to timers and we click run now. Okay, our timer has run. Let's check our data. Start with product cache, view data, no records. Okay, sorry for that. So name and description did not have enough length. And then later on, I found that the CTE was blowing up as it was being processed because it was missing the ID. So the output structure was not matching the structure on OutSystems. And that's why this query was not working properly. A new version has been published. Let's return to our product integration service, timers. Created the timer to clear the data from product cache and queue. Let's just run that to not have any data in the table. Okay, our clear data has worked. Return to product IS. One last check. Product cache, view data, no rows. Queue, view data, no rows. Okay. Let's now run again our fetch product data. Okay, our timer has ran. Let's check our data. Start with product cache. And there we go. We have all of our products in the cache here. Let's check our event queue. Here we go. We have our event queue. And we have like 1 to 10, 11 to 20, 21 to 24. So we have a total of 24 records. All of them have been processed. One thing we should mention is that light processes don't have tracking to run much faster, which increases the event processing throughout. And if you're interested, I can also show you the CTE working. So 1 to 10 test, and we get the 10 rows from 1 to 10. And if you want to change, check out the first row on the test out. So A0001, and if you change it, the rows from 10 to 20, A10 to A20. Okay, let's just check our final data. Okay, and as you can see, the table has the processed data in here. This proves that our integration pattern did its job. We hope our tutorial has been helpful to you. Now, when you have the need to integrate an external system, you should be able to apply any of the explained approaches. That'd be all for today, but please join us next time for more of our OutPower tutorials.